Good evening, all of you. See, so far we have been trying to focus on the Western, quote unquote, Anglo-Saxon economic model, which has proved to be questionable even in its application to the West. Nobody seriously disputes this apprehension that the way the West has led itself and has been trying to lead the world is itself not something which it should have done. It is admitted by from between 2005 and 2010 that there is nothing called a universal economic model, certainly not Western universalism as the economic model for the world. Why we have to again and again repeat, it would not be necessary to say this in Japan. I don't think a German educational institution would need to say this. I don't think in China anybody would believe that the economic model which is theorized in the laboratories of the West would be applicable in China. But in India it is needed because India has been in a state of colonization intellectually, academically, politically, in more than one, in socially, in the sociological sense of the term. We don't have our own sociological theory. With the result, this colonization has somehow made us believe that we better import these things. We have not, we don't have anything to call as our own, as something which could make us succeed. Have we ever been a success? These are all the questions which the intellectual education in India, the public discourse in India, and if it is very inconvenient for you to listen to me from there, you can come and sit here. So, if the whole discourse in India is to make us feel that we were never a performing nation, unless we understand, answer this question, whether we are at all we were performers, unless we have a history of performance or a history of underperformance. If we have a history of underperformance, then your academic discourse, your public discourse that India has to look elsewhere for generating its development model is completely right. But if you have a history of performance, then obviously this idea that we have to import everything from elsewhere is obviously wrong. So, what is important is history. The first proposition is this Anglo-Saxon economic model has been admitted to be a questionable model for non-Anglo-Saxon countries. And France and Germany rejected it outright in the G20 conference and made the G20 pass a resolution that this casino capitalism, which they call the financial capitalism, is called as the Anglo-Saxon casino capitalism, it will not be workable in non-Anglo-Saxon countries. But the proposition I am trying to advance is, even on the discourse and the debate which is taking place in the United States, which is the core laboratory to trot out theories of Anglo-Saxon financial capitalism, has come to the conclusion that the past 30 years of macroeconomic research on which the current financial capitalism is founded, which separates the real economy from the cash economy, it is useless at best and positively harmful at worst. See, this is a conclusion. It is no more something which is to be debated. So, today there is no Anglo-Saxon or financial capitalist theories which is proven to be a functional theory. A contextual success has made it the text. A contextual affair can never become the text. Unfortunately, the contextual success of financial capitalism for about 15-20 years after the onset of globalization has made this contextual success of the financial capitalist model into a text which was rudely shaken by the 2008 financial crisis. And by 2010, between 2005 and 2010, this discourse takes place. The World Bank and IMF come to the conclusion that there is no hold all economic model, one size doesn't fit all, everybody will have to look at their own what will succeed. So these are all signals leading to questions which were unanswerable questions which were raised in 2008 crisis, and by 2010 it is concluded this Anglo-Saxon model is questionable even in Anglo-Saxon countries. The first proposition is the proposition on which we are founding our entire course. You will not find outside this concept which we are expounding here something which is questionable except in the Marxist school of thought. The Marxist school of thought poses another question. The entire production mechanism is to be in the hands of the proletariat and the state should control everything. Ultimately the state will also wear away and so we will have a perfect society. This has proved to be not a workable model, not a practical model. And so leaving aside the Marxian school of thought, outside this focus which we are giving in this class, there is no theoretically, practically, philosophically sound way of approaching how this Anglo-Saxon financial model is not applicable to a country like India. This is the most important thing. This is the, that is why we have not devised this course as just a financial model or a management model. We are devising it as economic, business, financial model, because all three are interrelated. You cannot have an economic model which is divorced from the financial model. You cannot have a financial model which is divorced from the business model. You cannot have either of these things which is divorced from the social model. So unless you integrate all these issues and have focus, and it must be related not by just seeing mine is good, no. Whether mine is workable is more important than whether mine is good or not. So that is what we are going to say. The most important thing is look at the history. You know, in 2008 crisis, several persons came out with their explanation as to how we have to refocus, reappraise and relook at the economic thinking theory and the policies that we are framing. And Bradford Dellum is one of the most well known economists and academicians. He said that you have to first look at history. Unless you look at the history, because history of each country, each society is different from that of the other. That means once you give history its role, then every country has its history, every society has its history, and so you have to look at the history. What is the history in India? All of us were told and we believed, and most of us continue to believe, that India has been an underperformer in economics. This is the normal thing. Otherwise something over, we were great in the past, but no one knows. That we were great in the past is a matter of belief. We want to believe. That is why we believe we are great in the past. That's how actually in the 2010 Avenues program, this the seed for this course was laid when Adi Godrej spoke, saying that India might have been a great country culturally, socially, spiritually, in arts, music, in everything. Our spirituality is to be exported to the world to see that there is peace and harmony in the world instead of conflicting religions. But we were an economically underperforming society. We were steeped in illiteracy, we were steeped in backwardness, and only after the onset of globalization we came to understand what is prosperity, standard of living, quality of life. All these things we came to know only after the onset of globalization. This is what Mr. Godrej spoke. And then when I spoke, the points on which I trying to give an alternative perception. I was not just trying to rebut him. The points on which I was giving the alternative perception became the seed for this course. That's what I am going to tell you now. historically was India an economically underperforming society, an underperforming nation? This is the question. The answer has been yes, it was an underperforming society. You ask any average economic thinker in India, an economic student or even a professor, they would say no. In fact, I had the opportunity of being with the chairman of the advisory council to the Prime Minister on economic affairs. In fact, when I explained all this, I had only one sentence answer. No, these were all prior to 19th century, no, that is not going to be of guidance to us. You see the academic approach in India, I wouldn't call this perversion, I wouldn't call this distortion, these are all very strong words, but the approach is to be dismissive of India's performance. Okay, you dismiss India's performance, but don't call it an underperformer. You, by calling India an underperforming nation, for generations, for thousands of years, you have created an underperforming mind, underperforming society, an underperforming economy, an underperforming polity. A demeaning attitude to ourselves has been created by not looking at history. History is important for two purposes. The victories and your performance enhances your confidence. Your defeats should enhance your resolve. This is the way leaders must lead, but neither intellectual leaders nor political leaders or social leaders or the media or public intellectuals gave India this particular direction. It is said when the Second World War was going on, it is a skit written in one of the newspapers that Stalin, Hitler and Churchill, they were sitting by the side of a pond. You know, at that time the Allies were facing virtual defeat and England was being pounded, France run over, Russia on the defense, America had not entered into the fray, and Japan has come right up to Rangoon. So this was the state of affairs. So this skit is about how a national resolve has to be kept up. So all three are sitting and they said, you have to capture the fish in the pond. How will you capture? Then Hitler said, I am an ace shooter, I will shoot all the fish and bag them, and there is nothing, there will be except water, all the fish will be in my hands. Then Stalin said, I am an ace swimmer, I can swim and catch the fish. Then both of them look at Churchill, huge man. You see, you both of you do this, then I will tell you what I will do. So this fellow kept on shooting. Do you mean to say you can shoot and catch fish? He accepted failure. Then Stalin began swimming. You can't swim like fish, you couldn't catch it. The both of them accepted defeat. Then they asked Churchill, what are you going to do? He went and sat by the side of the pond and began hauling water with the spoon, the teacup spoon, and he kept on hauling the water. They asked, what are you doing? I will haul all the water this way and all the fish will be mine. Theoretically, he can never be defeated. You know, this is the how resolve of a nation is kept by leaders. I have no great opinion about Churchill except that he was the leader of England. He is no example to us. But all that we have to understand is that leaders keep up the resolve of the people in the face of defeat, and not concoct defeat, not concoct underperformance or dismiss performance. This is something very peculiar to Indian intellectualism. That's what I saw at display, either ignorance or dismissive attitude or somehow saying our success is no success, we have to find new ways of succeeding. So that is what laid the foundation for this course. The perception, which I called and proved as myth, that India is an underperforming nation. It is a complete myth. That's what we are going to do. Unless you say there is proof, unless you say the reality is different, the myth is real. And the myth becomes proof also, because our mind is frozen into believing you are no good. And to decolonize this mind, you require enormous amount of evidence. And the evidence is not something which you produce. Dadabhai Nawroji produced evidence. Nobody bothered about it. R.C. Dutt produced evidence. Nobody bothered about it. We are not citing evidence from within the country. We have to cite evidence from outside the country. Researchers, institutional work, powerful intellectuals saying what the situation is. That is the reality. What is that reality? You know how this myth came into being and how the myth has been exploded. Unless we know both, it is not possible for us to decolonize our mind. How did the myth come into being? First, Karl Marx. Max Weber. Winston Churchill. J.K. Galbraith. Professor Raj Krishna. Karl Marx was 1853, even before he wrote the Das Kapital, on the 22nd and 23rd June 1853, he wrote a couple of articles in the New York Herald Tribune, which is now the International Herald Tribune, saying that India is a stagnant and status quo society. Then in the early part of 1920s, Max Weber expounded disqualification theory. Winston Churchill, anarchy theory. J.K. Galbraith, functioning anarchy theory. Professor Raj Krishna, Hindu rate of growth. You must understand how myth gets perpetuated without facts. Karl Marx, he wrote a couple of articles, I told you. I think they have been circulated to you. You must read those articles for the sheer brilliance of analysis by a person who never visited India, who never saw any Indian intellectual, who had no understanding of Indian literature, but he commented on India and concluded his opinion about India and convinced India. You must understand how there is a huge gap between what we believe to be study and what we believe to be conclusions. What he said is very, very important. I think it is worth reading it. British rule in India, sorry, the date is 10th February 1853. He says there cannot, however, remain any doubt but that the mystery inflicted by the British on Hindustan is an essentially different and infinitely more intensive in kind than all Hindustan had to suffer before. I do not allude to European despotism planted upon Asian despotism, Asiatic despotism by the British East India Company, forming a more monstrous combination than any of the divine monsters startling us in the temple of Celeste. There is no distinctive feature of the British colonial rule, but only an imitation of the Dutch, and so much that in order to characterize the working of the British East India Company, it is sufficient literally to repeat what Sir John Stamford Raffles, the English convener of Java, said of the old Dutch East India Company. All civil wars, I am not quoting that because it is not necessary, all civil wars, invasions, revolutions, conquests, famines, strangely complex, rapid and destructive or the successive action, Hindustan may appear, but did not go deeper than its surface. Nothing affected the functioning of the Indian society. Wars have been there, devastations have been there, 4.5 million people had been killed between the 13th century and the 19th century. Thousands of temples were razed down, nothing affected India. That is what he says. England has broken down the entire framework of Indian society without any symptoms of reconstitution yet appearing. The loss of his old world with no gain of new one imparts a particular kind of melancholy to the present day misery of the Hindu and separates Hindustan ruled by British from all its ancient traditions and from the whole of its past history. Because we were told, your past is so rotten, so dark, so unenviable, don't look at it. The best way of making a person feel inferior is to think, make him think that his grandfather was a brute and his great grandfather was even worse. This is what Swami Vivekananda said. That was the education system. A new leadership had been produced on that basis. So, there have been in Asia, generally from immemorial times, but three departments of government, of finance, the plunder of interior, that of war, or the plunder of the exterior. Finally, the department of public works, climate and territorial conditions, especially vast tracts of desert extending from Sahara to Arabia, Persia, India and Tartary to the most elevated Asiatic highlands, constituted artificial irrigation by canals and waterworks as the basis for Occidental agriculture. It is very important. Sitting from there, he analyzes how in India there has been a functioning governance and how the public works have been looked after, waterworks have been looked after, because these all reports from East India Company travelers and British government reports. As in Egypt and India, word is wrong. How soil is being used in Persia, advantage is taken of the highland, feeding, irrigating canals, the prime necessity of economic and something missing. So, what he says is the water flowing is from highland to the lowland. And that is how agriculture was sustained in this country. And this cut across many states, one kingdom to another kingdom, nobody stopped water. This is what he says, a centrally administered public work system sustained agriculture. See, artificial fertilization of the soil dependent on central government, ultimately decaying with the neglect of irrigation and drainage. This is precisely what is first affected by the British. You know, there is a study from Coorg to Thoothukudi. Series of lakes are there, Aries as they are called, maybe a few 100,000, and water flows like this, stored like this. This was first affected by railways and roadways without constructing any breaches between them. This is how the whole irrigation system was affected. So, after seeing all this, he says, one after another, he goes on to say how this entire agricultural economy, trade, industry was affected. There are two circumstances. The Hindu on the one hand, leaving like Occidental peoples to the central government, the care of the great public works, the prime condition of agriculture and commerce, dispersed on the other hand, over the surface of the country, agglomerated in small centers by domestic union of agriculture and manufacturing pursuits, which he later calls as the Asiatic method of production, that he theorizes. But it is from India, he takes this example. So, while the central government was looking after these public works and all that, people organized themselves in small villages. The two circumstances brought about, since the remotest times, a social system of particular features, the so called village system, so peculiar to India, which gave to each of the small union their independent organization and distinct life. The peculiar characteristic of the system may be judged from the following description contained in an old official report of the British House of Commons. I am not going to disturb you with that because it is a very huge report. So what he says is that the society has had a functioning economic model, and he went on to say there is arrangement was reciprocal. Nobody was dominating the society with his capacity to produce something which was shared by a common system. Everybody in the village had a share in the food that was produced. Everybody had to work, and without money. It was purely the work culture of the people which made the economy reciprocal. Now, sickening as it must be to the human feeling to witness these myriad of industrious, patriarchal and inoffensive social organizations disorganized and dissolved into these units, thrown into the sea of ooze, and the individual members losing at the same time their ancient form of civilizations and their hereditary means of subsistence, we must not forget these idyllic village communities, inoffensive though they may appear, had always been solid foundation of oriental despotism. Now he says, yes, the British is doing this destruction, but let me look at this society. That they remained the human, restrained the human mind within the smallest possible canvas, making it unresisting tool of superstition, enslaving beneath the traditional rules, depriving it of all grandeur and historic energies. The man has absolutely no understanding of the huge intellectual work that has happened in India. He didn't know about Bhaskaracharya. He didn't know about Sulba Sutras. He didn't study Marco Polo, who said that India built ships to last for 100 years. He had no understanding. He only read the colonial literature and is forming opinions. This is a third-rate society. We must not forget that this undignified, stagnatory and vegetative life, that this passive sort of existence revoked on the part, that contradistinction, wild, aimless, unbounded forces of destruction, and rendered murder itself a religious rite in Hindustan. We must not, okay, he goes on to say, what is this society? It is worshipping monkeys. It is worshipping cows. See how a person who is not part of the milieu of the society, now it is supposed to be promoting ecology, environmental balance. The same studies, the same Western societies, intellectuals today study. The Tulsi Puja and Vriksha Puja are for promoting forest and wildlife. I mean, there is another interpretation also. But this man's materialistic interpretation goes to the extent of saying that he raises this question ultimately. England, it is true, is causing a social revolution in Hindustan, and it was accentuated only by the vilest of interest and was stupid in the manner of enforcing them. But that is not the question. The question is, can mankind fulfill its destiny without fundamental revolution in the social state of Asia? This is where he brings in the Marxist theory. A society cannot progress without revolution. And India is incapable of revolting. And the British is breaking down the social system of India to prepare India for revolution. If not, whatever may have been the crimes of England, she was unconscious tool of history in bringing about that revolution. Then, whatever bitterness the spectacle of crumbling of an old world may have for our personal feelings, we have the right in point to exclaim with Goethe that the destruction is painful, it is pleasurable also. He quotes Goethe to say that the British causing destruction is really painful to us, but it is also pleasurable because it is preparing India for a revolution. But with all that, India could never be prepared for revolution, you know. But the fact remains, his stagnation theory and a status quo theory attempt to depict India as a backward society eternally, unless it was completely debased and a new India is produced, it is useless. Karl Marx. Then came Max Weber. All these, of course, I have given in your course materials. Max Weber, he theorized modern capitalism is a product of Protestant Christianity. This is his famous, and he further said it is methodological individualism. Which is the basis of the society. Later on, it became of economics. This is the most important thing. This theory he expounded and said all the Protestant nations are growing fast. Catholic nations are stagnating because Protestantism releases individual energies, individual freedom, and produces risk bearers who are not weighed in by any respect for elders, any respect for other institutions, and a man is on his own. So the social energies released produces entrepreneurs, and entrepreneurship is the basis of modern capitalism. So market capitalism will be sustained by entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is possible only by promoting individualism. To promote individualism means is to debase the organizational control over the individual. This is, I do not want to take you deeper into it, the concept of social contract theory, which replaced the divine right theory. You know, in West, the king is supposed to have the divine right to rule, to kill, to plunder. That was replaced by the social contract theory of Hobbes, who wrote the book Leviathan and said, yes, all this he has, because he protects the people. So people have handed over their individual freedom to him, to the king, because he protects them in return. This was the social contract theory till Locke came and explained, no, he may have all the rights of the individuals with him, but it must be with consent. That is how democracy came into being. But even under democracy, the same divine right theory inhered, because the concept of king can do no wrong is there in all the European nations even today. King can do no wrong, but the Supreme Court of India declared that principle never applied in India, it will never apply in India. But I do not think anyone has even studied this judgment. Even lawyers have not studied this judgment. That stream of thinking that king is everything, he can kill. Based on which the Leviathan theory, on the basis of which the modern social contract theory, on which the constitution of all countries including India is founded, that was founded on the basis the state can do no wrong. But in India it was never accepted. With the result, I will tell you, slightly digress and say, you know, there was a case during the emergency. Everybody was arrested, fundamental rights were suspended, and people were thrown in jail. And so 14 high courts decided it was wrong. You cannot do it. Fundamental rights have been suspended, right to life, right to property, right to free speech, right to movement, everything has been suspended. But still, in India it cannot happen. This is what the 14 high courts decided. The matter went to the Supreme Court. It is the famous ADM Jabalpur case. In fact, if you have time, you must read it, because this is a judgment for which the Supreme Court must hang its head in shame. The Supreme Court decided on the basis of an argument advanced by Mr. Niren Day, who was the Attorney General. He said, when the court asked him, one of the fundamental rights is the right to life, right to live. Do you mean to say it can be suspended by government? He said, it may shock your conscience, my lord, if when the fundamental rights are suspended, if a person is illegally killed by a police official, this court is helpless. Will you believe our court accepted this? It is based on the social contract theory, king can do no wrong, divine right theory, it is all flowing from this evolution. But in India this was never applicable. You can never suspend the right to live in India because the king never had that right. People never handed over that right to the king. Even the property right was not handed over. The king cannot, according to our traditional laws, take over the property of the people. Property of the people is common to the king. I think the Arthashastra studies which the group is here making, they will vouchsafe this. In India, the king did not have what is known as the right of eminent domain, which is the fundamental principle of land acquisition. Huge paradigm difference. But Max Weber said that this is the basis on which prosperity will be generated. I could understand because he was right. All the Protestant nations were growing fast and Catholic nations were stagnating. But now, this he said sometime in 1897 to something like 1910, this was his research. Absolutely right. The rise of America and the stagnation of most of these Catholic countries. In 1925, he wrote a book, Religion of Hinduism and Buddhism. In which he simply came to a conclusion that these two countries, India and China, will never rise because they believe in karma and rebirth. Simple formulation, because it doesn't give individual freedom, it doesn't promote enterprise, it will not promote entrepreneurship. All I have given reference materials. The two greatest influence on Indian academia, intellectuals, Indian public discourse, well, Karl Marx and Max Weber, who expounded the disqualification theory. India is disqualified for development, and China also. Then came Churchill. We all quote Churchill because he spoke good English. Churchill said, this is an anarchic society. You are going to give them freedom. Gandhi said, we prefer anarchy to despotism. He was the only intellectual challenge to the entire arrogant West. He went with the least amount of clothes. The media asked him, Mr. Gandhi, you are so poorly dressed. He said, the king has more than what I lack. He has that extra dress. He is wearing more than what he should. You know, the philosophy, he completely, and 1931, the man went. And he challenged physically, by his appearance, he challenged the West. There is no intellectual continuity in this country. I will tell you the consequences of it. Then came Galbraith. We got freedom. In 1962, Galbraith, a friend of India, a very great friend of Pandit Nehru, he became the ambassador to India, a great economist. In fact, I will quote at a particular point of time that his thoughts about economists and my thoughts are almost the same, which I will tell you at some point. A great economic thinker, he came to India and he said, India is a functioning anarchy. Meaning, it is anarchic, but still it is somehow going. It's moving. It is not stopping. It's working. It's breathing. In 2002, he came. So the media asked him this question, because afterwards he had passed away. Mr. Galbraith, you said we were a functioning anarchy. What do you say now? No. I didn't talk about the Indian society. I talked about the Indian state. Indian state is a functioning anarchy. The Indian society is not. That is how he escaped. But what he meant originally was that India was an anarchic society. And I have seen many of our intellectuals quoting this repeatedly, that we are a functioning anarchy. Then came Professor Rajkrishna in the year 1978. He had been an advisor to the government. He was in the planning commission. He was a socialist economic thinker. And so the media asked him a question, Mr. Rajkrishna, you have always been following the same socialist economic policies which Russia has been following, Poland is following, East Asian countries, East European countries are following, Yugoslavia is following, but they are all growing fast. But with the same policies, why are we not growing that fast? To which he said, what do? We can only have Hindu rate of growth. I do not know why the man said it, wanted to escape answering questions or off the cuff remark. That remark was taken by McNamara. The World Bank president, he addressed at least half a dozen conferences saying an Indian policy maker, economist, thinker has said this country will never grow and I appeal to you for aid for that country. That was the debate and discourse, that was the image and brand of India in 1980-81. All of us must say, we are thinking people. If repeatedly such great men rate, brand, conclude, characterize a society, how will it feel? That is how we felt. So in the same way, this was the basis on which Mr. Adi Godrej said we were a non-performing society. He was right, because that is what is taught, that is what is discussed. That was the time when I had to begin to speak. I said this happened in 1978. In 1983, something else happens. Paul Bayrock, a Belgian economist, came out with an outstanding study saying what happened in the world between 1750 and 1900. It is a very interesting table he just take three regions, India, China and US and UK. In 1750, India's share of world GDP was 24.5, that of China 32.8 and that of England and US 2%. And in 1830, it becomes 17.6. 29.8 and this becomes 13.3. In 1900, sorry, I will also add 1880. Because this is important, the crash after 1880 to 1900 we must all see. This is 17.6, 1880 and then 29.8, this is 12.3, 1900, India 1.7. China 6.2, these both of them put together 42.1. This is what Paul Bayrock said, that this is how the crash occurred. On this basis, historians like Fetnan Braudel said that India must have had a much better standard of living than us in the 17th and 18th centuries. This is something which shook the West. How could it be? How could what we thought as a bad society, backward society, useless society, underperforming society, could have had such higher standard of living than us as late as 1750. This was the question. So they wouldn't take it like that. Then the OECD countries, Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, which is a network of all the developed nations, they constituted a Development Studies Institute under Angus Madison, the greatest economic historian ever. They said, you have to verify this and tell us whether what Paul Bayrock said is correct or not. Then Angus Madison postulated, before he started the study, if Bayrock is right, then much more of the backwardness of the third world, quote India and China, presumably has to be explained by colonial exploitation, and much less of Europe's advantage can be due to scientific precocity, continuous slow accumulation, and organizational skills and financial superiority can only be additives. The core issue is, if this is right, if the fall is from 60 to 8, it can only be due to colonial exploitation. And he says, I don't think Paul Bayrock is right. This is what Angus Madison says, and sets out to do the research and comes with his conclusion, and let us see what his conclusions are. He studied not 150 years, he studied 2000 years. First year of the common era, 1000, 1400, 1500, 1700. After 1700, more or less he agrees with Paul Bayrock. In the first year of the common era, India, China. India is 32%, China is 25.4%, India 28%, China 22%, India 24.3%, China 24.8%. This is 1500, 1600, 22.3%, China 22.2%, India 24.4%, and China 22.2% again. Sorry, it's 23.9%. The game was between these two countries. America was virtually not on the scoreboard, being not a country at that time. So when Angus Madison concluded this, he didn't conclude only this. He said it is only because of colonial exploitation India lost. He came to that conclusion very honestly, and he kept on publishing his research papers from 2001. This is World Economic History, a Millennial Perspective. A Millennial Perspective, which has been accepted as the most authentic economic history of the world, and it is on OECD website, completely outside the intellectual realms of India. No high-end educational institution in India was even aware of it till 2010. But is it just study? There are corroborative evidences, and the corroborative evidences prove that it could not be just statistics, it is something more. You look at what are the corroborative evidences. Ancient history book, Pliny, Natural History. This is Fordham, Fordham Educational Institution, their study. It shows one, the Roman historical records which confirm how India was draining Roman Empire of huge gold year after year. Rome was losing not less than 50 million sesterces, equal to 162.5 million in trade every year. Pliny the Elder claims that the trade with India leaves some 50 million sesterces each year deficit for Rome. This is Greco-Roman record. You see it in any of our social studies history textbooks, this quote. According to a research title, Religion and Economic Activities in India, a Historical Perspective, Rajiv H. Dahejia and Vivek Dahejia, and this is carried in the American Journal of Economics and Sociology in April 18, 1993. They say the wealth of the Mauryan Empire is attributed to its thriving land and sea trade with China and Sumatra to the east, Ceylon in the south, Persia and Mediterranean to the west. The silk routes from Europe to China put India at the center of the vibrant land trade route, but the Mauryans had also a well-developed merchant navy. Connecting many parts of the empire was an excellent system of roads, and along with those trade routes were marts or towns where goods were assembled from all parts of the civilized world. Among the goods that were traded were silks, textiles, brocades, rugs, perfumes, etc., etc. Somewhat like the internal road network was an arterial system through which the entire empire participated in foreign trade and reaped its benefit. Somewhat like the modern newly industrialist countries, the Mauryan Empire enjoyed export-led growth. Not that this is statistics. This was achieved by a huge economic infrastructure, trading habits, financial habits. You know, from Persia down to Calcutta, there was a trade language called Kharosthi, which was common. You Google it, you will find it. Languages were different, but the trade people had invented Kharosthi language, so that language barriers did not affect trade intercourse. Tell me which economic textbook in India contains this Kharosthi reverence. Then in 1934, the Bank of International Settlement came out with its fifth report. What do they say? An estimate of the magnitude of hoards, this is about gold. You know, in those days, gold was the only medium of exchange. If you had to import something, you had to pay in gold. There is no other way you could settle the account because there was no common denominator. And see the history of gold for 400 years in India. This is Bank of International Settlement, which was newly formed at that time. In 1929 it was formed. It is its fifth report. An estimate of the magnitude of the hoards amassed by countries in the east must necessarily be somewhat vague. In addition to imperfect statistics, it is difficult to account for the amount lost or destroyed. The movements in the past 100 years, which can be fairly well ascertained, are however more important than those in the earlier period. It has been tentatively estimated that the whole gold hoarded by Indian public from 1493 to 1930, almost 500 years, it would amount to a minimum of 16.5 billion Swiss francs, or about 14 to 24% of world gold production. One quarter of world's gold production were absorbed by India, means that was the trade surplus of India. The world production during the period, but from 1931 to 1934, you must read this report. You will shed not tears but blood. 1/6 of it was lost only in this 4-year period. 1/6 of the gold accumulated by India through export surplus, India lost in this 4-year period according to this report. Why India will not crash? Third, this fourth, Marco Polo's travelogue talks about how cheap gold was in India. It says gold had such, India was such plentiful in gold that the exchange rate of gold to silver in India was 6 ounces of gold for 1 ounce of silver. Whereas in Europe it was the other way around, 10 ounces of silver for 1 ounce of gold, because the trade was so difficult to do, because gold and silver are very difficult to transport. Even if gold is in surplus in one place, you cannot take it to another place because of piracy, because of theft. Gold used to remain where it is actually. Gold never used to move out except in the 20th century only gold started moving, according to the Bank of International Settlement. Huge transactions in gold began taking place only in the 20th century. Can you believe gold was in such excessive supply that the arbitrage between gold and silver was almost 20 times. Now I will read out what the address of the Chief of Naval Staff at the International Seafarers Day in Mumbai on 25/6/2011. What does he say? Again, Marco Polo talks about how Indian ships were much larger than the ships of Europe, and the merchant navy strength of India in the pre-colonial days also indicated the trade power of India. In fact, the Indian trade was so extensive around 70 AD, the Roman governor Pliny the Elder, about whom I told you, who spoke about the export surplus of India, Pliny the Elder wrote that as many as 125 Indian ships usually lay at the ports of Egypt and Rome continuously, either disembarking goods or embarking goods. As late as the 14th century, Marco Polo remarked that the Indian ships were built to last for 100 years, and that some were large enough to require crews of 150 to 300 men. India's share of world's economy was 30% in this period, and he says later it crashed. Against 34,500 Indian ships that entered and cleared the Indian ports in 1857, 34,500 ships, only about 1700 did in 1900. 34,500 ships in 1700. In just 200 years, the number comes down to 1,700. By 1947, the Indian merchant marine had declined to only 11 ocean going ships and a tonnage capacity of 73,000. We had a million ton capacity in 1857. In just 90 years, instead of a million ton capacity growing to 30 million, 40 million, it comes down to 73 million. And I will, you see, it's a, India was probably the greatest merchant navy nations in the world. In fact, the very word navy came from the word navy. It is now etymologically accepted. We only knew the art of shipping, building ships. We knew the art of building ships without steel. That is why it never got rusted. So this all, three-decked ships were built. And I will read out some parts to understand, because history is so important for us to understand how technical excellence this country had achieved. It is not just artistic beauty, building temples. Temples is also a great technological factor. You must, how many of you have gone and seen the Tanjore temple? One. You know, Tanjore temple, the gopuram is like this. There is a 20 ton top, very minutely sculptured. It was not taken there and sculptured, it was sculptured. you know, a slope was completely built. It's about 12 kilometers. It is called Saram in Tamil. That village name is even now Saram. And it is pulled upwards with elephants and placed there. It is now 1,000 years. It is still there. Has any one of the engineering, civil engineering faculty ever studied how great this architecture is? No cement, everything, it is stone for stone approach. Inside it is a huge art gallery. It's not art, it's technology. Why I'm saying this? We had achieved all this. In fact, Jairam Ramesh once told me, Guru, whatever you may say, we have lost all this. You see this Delhi Qutub Minar steel structure, this alloy structure. 1,000 years it is exposed to sun, it is exposed to winter, it is exposed to everything. It has not rusted. But this alloy technology we have lost. It's over. But it's not over. You know, Madras University is tabulating the manuscripts of India available all over the world in 44 volumes. Only the name of the manuscript, where it is available, no other particular, another subject, 44 volumes. They are compiling, they will complete it next year. They have produced 28 volumes and handed over to me. I swooned. Philadelphia University, 50,000 manuscripts of India, 100,000 manuscripts out of it relate to astronomy. We have not opened it. How will you connect yourself to the past? How is it that Shulbha Sustra came from Bodhayana? We never knew till 20 years back. Disconnect. So it requires enormous amount of understanding and study to rebuild the Indian mind. And unless you rebuild the Indian mind in every sense of the term, you cannot rebuild the Indian mind on economic issues alone, on business issues alone. So one thing is proved, that this entire myth that India was an underperformer was completely demolished by not only the study on statistics, but also on broader supporting and corroborating materials. And I will just read out certain references about Indian shipping, which is very necessary because shipping is the very basis. Chinese Admiral Cheng Ho came to India in the closing years of the 14th century AD. He discovered that the ships of his fleet were midgets compared with the Indian ships which sailed in the Indian Ocean like giants. In an account of a voyage, Friar Odoric, an Italian monk, made across the Indian Ocean in the 14th century, he mentions that the ships which could carry he mentions Indian ships which could carry 700 people. Marco Polo and Niccolo Contini have left records of trades by Indian ships in the 13th and 15th century. Ayn e Akbari, that is Akbar's newspaper, records the shipping under Emperor Akbar 1556 to 1605 was administered equally well as under the Mauryas 1900 years earlier. It is a continuity. It didn't stop anywhere. As many as 40,000 Indian ships are recorded and known to have been plying in and around the Indian Ocean during the reign of Akbar. And now what the British does? They completely destroy this industry. The famous British Act of Navigation 1651 stipulated no goods whatsoever of the growth, produce or manufacture of Asia, Africa or America should be imported into England or Ireland or any other plantations except directly in ships belonging to English subjects, of which the master and the greater number of crew were Englishmen. This was the first law they passed. In 1811, Fort William in Bengal imposed double import duty on goods carried by non-British built ships. Fort St. George in Madras and Fort David in Bombay followed suit in 1812 and 1813 respectively. During the, but East India Company recorded that the Bhavnagar built Indian ship Darya Dhaulat was sound even after 87 years of active service. This evidences the superiority of the Indian ships. Lauji Wadia Company built 355 ships in Bombay for East India Company over 150 years. First in Surat, then in Bombay between 1781 and 1821, ships built on the Hooghly River alone aggregated to 1,22,713 tons. Shipyards in Bepur near Calicut even built warships for Royal Navy. One such ship of the line was part of Nelson's fleet at Trafalgar Square on October 2, 1805. This is with which Nelson bet the American national anthem, Star Spangled Banner, was composed by Francis Kay when he was on a visit to Baltimore and was sitting in the decks of the ship Minden built in Bombay. It's a series of things and how they destroy the whole thing. By the order of the Governor General in Council, Fort William, Revenue Department published the following order on 14 January 1789. Notice is given hereby given that all persons whatsoever are prohibited from making use of or constructing boats for the of the following denominations and dimensions after March 31st next. That means no shipbuilding allowed in India. And that any carpenter, blacksmith or artificer engaging or employed in building or repairing of boats and descriptions of the above shall be committed to close imprisonment in Faujidari jail for any period not above 1 month or suffer corporeal punishment not exceeding 20 strokes with a rattan. So Mahatma Gandhi said ultimately that Indian shipping had to perish so that the British shipping might flourish. The merchant navy of India was destroyed, trade power of India was destroyed, agriculture of India was destroyed, manufacturing of India was destroyed. That is why India became poor. It's a proven fact. Why India fell? India did not fall for economic reasons or because of wrong economic behavior. We have responsible economic behavior even now because of our past responsible behavior. In fact, the modern economic theories are not shaking India because of the traditionally inherited economic behavior. You are asked to spend, you are not spending. Why? Such attractive goods are available, Indians are refusing to spend. They are saving, Japanese are saving, East Asians are saving. Why? It is because of the inherited culture, society, norms, behavioral models, the social milieu against exorbitant way of living, exhibitive way of living. All this controls consumption, promotes savings. It is not interest rates. Interest rates do not promote savings. It's something else, non-economic reasons. So the entire socio-economic cultural basis of the Western model and the Indian model have been different, and India has been in reality and by proof, India has been an economic, not only an economic success, India had been an economically top performer in the world. It is an undeniable thing, but unfortunately, none of these facts are known. I am going to quote one more, and with this, we will come to this stage that in reality, India was a great economically performing, not only performing nation, but it was also an economic superpower for 1700 years. See, I am going to quote to you a study, West Asia and the region, defining India's role, edited by Rajendra Abhyankar, Center for West Asian Studies, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. This study is dated 1978. According to the Edinburgh Review, an ordinary unskilled laborer in Allahabad, Varanasi area got more wages than his counterpart in Britain in 1803-1804. It goes on to, there was no labor union here. You know, in Srimad Bhagavatam, there is a sloka which says that a person who does not pay adequately to compensate the work of the labor, and the person who doesn't serve loyally his employer, both are doing adharma. This is the principle. And it also says in Kali Yuga, the laborers will be robbed by the employer by not paying adequately, and the employee will be disloyal to the employee. This is how our belief system, that if you move towards this, you are moving towards the age of darkness. Kali is the age of darkness. This is how we legislated norms, socially legislated norms. This is how it worked. It goes on to observe that the tools of agriculture were of high sophistication, but so also seemed to be the various agricultural practices, including the selection of seeds use, the preservation, manuring land, the cropping patterns, and the methods of irrigation. The review compares agricultural production in Allahabad, Varanasi region with that of the lands in Britain. It has found that the Indian production of wheat was about 1.5 to 3 times that in Britain. Recent ongoing research pertaining to the district of Chengalpattu in Tamil Nadu, by an institution with which I am associated, Center for Policy Studies, seems to suggest that the average production of paddy in this district was in around 1770 was about 3 to 4 tons per hectare, and the best lands in the district produced 6 tons per hectare. It may be mentioned here that high yields of paddy production in the world today are around 6 tons per hectare. The wages of agricultural laborer in Chengalpattu 1780 to 1925 was 750 at 1975 prices, while the wages in 1975 in this area was just 2.5 rupees. That was in kind. This is in currency. In 1806, a survey was conducted by Britain in Bellary and Karappa districts. Very important, because these are the poorest districts, dry districts, no rain. The British conducted a study. The whole thing has been put into research and brought out by Dharampal, and his book has been put on free on the net, and I have given the link to you. You must read it. The Beautiful Tree, one of the finest collection. 15 years the man toiled outside India to prove Mahatma Gandhi was right when he said in 1931 that India had better literacy than England when England came in, and when England destroyed the literary base of India. Then Mahatma Gandhi was asked, what is your proof? He said, it's not my proof, it's my faith. In 1954, Dharampal decided Gandhi could never tell a lie. Then he went about to do the research, and the result was that beautiful book called The Beautiful Tree. So in the Kadapa and Bellary districts, the entire population was divided into 3 categories: high income, medium income, low income. This is all there in your course material. There were 2.59 lakh homes in the high income bracket. 2.59 lakhs. You see how comparable the figures are. 2.59, high income. Then medium income, 3.73. Low income, 2.19. And it goes on to say, the consumption pattern was also studied in detail. 24 items were selected in the consumption list. Per capita income of the high income group was 17 rupees, 3 anas and 4 paisa. Here the medium 9 rupees, 2 anas and 4 paisa. Low income 7 rupees, 7 anas, 0 paisa. The ratio is 69, 37 and 30. This was during the British period, and during Akbar's period, studies show that during the regime of Akbar, the consumption of the people of India was more than the consumption of the people during the colonial regime. During Akbar's period, it was more, not less. Tell me, is the statistics wrong or well corroborated? But where is the study of history? What made the people behave that way? There was no state, there was no police. Because the social norms were so well observed by examples, by local leadership, by a social order. It had its, every country had a social order which had its plus and minuses. Many wrong things have happened in every society. But if you look at the website built by R.J. Rummel, a professor, about how killings have taken place in the world, he estimates 1.4 billion killings. Till the 20th century. In India, he estimates till 13th century, it was in thousands. Between 13th and 19th century, it was 4.51 million, that's all. 1.4 billion killings. Here, till the 13th century, there are only two kinds of killings, he reports. One is sati. The other is thuggies. So there was a comparatively peaceful society, peaceful economy. But this is not the picture we get. The picture we get is this: stagnant, backward, disqualified, anarchy, barbaric. Churchill said in 1931, when he came to England, Bangalore, he stayed there for some time. He said it is a barbaric society. At least Karl Marx said it is semi-barbaric. Churchill said it is barbaric. And we say Churchill said this about India. India will go into anarchy. Right, this is the only country which has not gone into anarchy. Even if there is no government, there will be no anarchy in this country. What happened in Russia? What happened in England? What happened in Germany? What happened in America? 200 million people were eliminated in America. 200 million is the latest estimate. And that is not anarchic, orderly killing. Here stone throwing is anarchy. We cannot demean ourselves much more. The English educated intellectual in India has debranded India. We must realize it. We must study it very objectively because we are a part of that group. I am in part of that group. So, the whole picture that has been presented is a completely wrong picture. When I mentioned all this, then some of the academics and students of IIT, SJOM came to me. Am I right? No. So, they came to me and said, sir, don't stop with this one lecture. Conduct a course for us. That is how this course came into being. This is not a class. This is not a course for marks. You know, all of you have passed out virtually. in where you not only passed out, maybe you got your placements. But you must understand, India needs this reassessment about itself. It needs a reorientation. It needs honest introspection. It needs an unbiased attitude to itself and to others. I am not saying we are the great. Nobody is great in this world. It is only comparatively we have been a better society. Comparatively we have been a better economy. For example, China. It was an empire builder. It killed millions to build the Chinese wall. The Great Wall of China was built at the cost of millions of people. They were killed. They don't work. But I don't think anybody was killed to build the huge Tanjore temple. See, the same world class performance, one at the cost of killing, other at the cost of reverence. The Indian society was built on reverence. Reverence to God, reverence to elders, reverence to parents, reverence to teachers. It is not easy to build these virtues. They are great social virtues, economic virtues. Remove reverence for parents, the state has to take care of the parents. That's proved. But you cannot build reverence by law. So the economic performance of India was not built on economic laws. It was built on social, family and cultural models that produced economic behavior which led to economic performance and which impacts on our economic behavior even today. And this is true of most of the Asian societies which are family based, which have traditional linkages, which have social continuity, which have not been reduced to atomized individualism. This is what I will try and explain tomorrow as to how this entire exercise of what is the difference between what we are and how there is a paradigm difference between these two approaches, I will try and deal with tomorrow. Most of the colonial destruction, the details are contained in Professor Kanagasabhapathy's book, which is with you. I need not have to repeat it, it is very well recorded. Will Durant has explained how India was completely looted and robbed. That book he wrote at the instance of Mahatma Gandhi. So great intellectual work has been done, but unfortunately, at least in the about the colonial destruction, lot of records are there, but we have not cared to read them. So we must understand all this, and all that I am seeking is that wherever you are going to get employed, whatever you are going to do, but keep this in mind, that you have a contribution to make to this country, to make this country look at it differently from the way it has been looking at so far, and that is your moral responsibility. And about the rest we will see tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Sir, looking at today's lecture, so where are we standing right now, and where are we lacking currently to reach the mark of US and UK? We do have a saving society, but are we lacking at a manufacturing side or a trading side, or where? How do we scale up to the Western country currently?
You see, we need not have to look at the Western countries which have become more financial economies. We have to look at our production mechanism. We have to build respect for production. So long as your civil engineers are going to join, not L&T engineering, but L&T Infotech, India will not become a manufacturing power. A.M. Naik used to cry to me, Gurumurthy, I need people to build infrastructure, roads, bridges. I want to build submarines for India. But these civil engineers who are to do this job are sitting in my Infotech office and drawing three times the salary than a civil engineer. And so we are having masons doing nation rebuilding work and engineers doing foreign building work. So we need a great amount of shift in our thinking. It will take place, don't worry. When the West declines, West is bound to decline because it has become purely currency based economy, credit based economy. And that is the question today from 2008. When that model fails, the alternative model will build. Otherwise, we will not respect this model.
Thank you, sir.
So we talk about the colonization. Are we again inviting FDI and all every areas? Are we again going back to retrograde the same thing? Or because Arvi said what we are doing innovation or what you are about manufacturing. Again, we said, I know one of your earlier videos, we developed the Tirupur belt, we created a entrepreneurs. In your video, I impressed that it built today Tirupur without having any manufacturing. Today, it's one of the hub. But again, why we are expecting that FDI? Are we favoring towards colonialism? Or
don't
we have
worry,
to
it is not coming anyway. Actually, in India, FDI is crowded out because there is huge domestic investment available. FDI is not moving into areas where the domestic investment is not moving. So, FDI is seeking opportunity in the Indian stock market. The largest FDI that has come into India, foreign investment, it is not foreign direct investment, foreign investment is in the stock market. So, the foreigners are not trusting a country more than 2 months, 3 months, 2 hours, 5 hours. You know, this is the kind of investment that is coming and going. See, this is, we are looking at foreign investment to finance our imports. We are not looking at foreign investment to build the economy.
Sir, I would just like to talk about a term known as uncertainty avoidance. When we look at the Western culture, there's something, the uncertainty avoidance is very low because they have something known as social security. And that's the reason why the people out there are spending. They're not worried about uncertainties which will come ahead in their life. For example, education has been taken care of, retirement has been taken care of, medical has been taken care of. Whereas in our society, we do not have a social security, and that's the reason to avoid this uncertainty, we Indians save. Now, in the same, that's the reason why I understand that the savings rate is very high in our country, because the psychology of the people is what will happen in future. We need to
see. This is what Alan Greenspan says. This is a backward society, so it has to save.
So, sir, in the same context, now when we have something known as the food security bill coming in, and the things where we are trying to give the security, where we are trying to make things more certain for people, would it? How would it affect? And what's your view on that particular?
You see, actually, food security bill requires a separate session by itself. I have written 3 articles on food security. Food security issue is not really giving food to people who do not produce food, who only consume food. You will be shocked to know 68% of the beneficiaries under the food security bill are people who are already producing food. The question is, if they are going to get food at 3 rupees a kilogram, why should they toil in their land and produce food for others? And they will rather go for horticulture or some growing vegetables or exotic crops, commercial crops, and make money. You know, there are 100 million small and marginal farmers who cultivate 41% of India's lands and produce 51% of India's food grains. It has been proved in 2001 that scale of economy is not applicable, scale of production is not applicable to agriculture. Smaller the farm, greater is the production. That is why it is said in North India, anyone who belongs to Punjab and Haryana will understand what I am saying. The Kurmi farm is more efficient than the Jat farm, because the Jats have large lands and Kurmis have small lands. It is because the entire family works on the land. Now, this 100 million farmers produce 51% of India's food grains, and most of their production, 80% of the production is consumed by them. For most of them, it is a backward integration of their kitchen. Let us assume you are saying, no, don't worry, I am going to give you grain. Why will they produce? Then where will the country give grains to them? This is my objection. if the producer is going to be turned into a consumer, who will produce for the consumer? This is a completely thoughtless scheme, and no media has discussed it. That's why I say there is no original economic thinking in India. When the Planning Commission 2007 report to the parliament says the small and marginal farmers are going to exist almost forever in this country, by 2061 our rural population will be 610 million, by 2061, much more in number than it is today. So it is a completely thoughtless scheme just for votes. See, I have done, you do it and do permanent damage to the country. So what America did in 1980, the great economic thinkers warned America, don't do it. Today you say, no, America is giving unemployment benefits, old age benefits, health insurance. The total, the present value of social security including health security, present value, if you reduce the future value into present value, it is 104 trillion. America's GDP is 16 trillion. This is what is driving America towards insolvency. You say, what you are saying, that no, don't run railways, it is unnecessary burden on the government. Don't run your bus transport, it is unnecessary burden on the government. Privatize it. When you want to privatize all this and saying it is an unnecessary burden on the government, it is inefficient. You are taking over the responsibilities of parents, sons, daughters. You will be more efficient in taking care of the parents than the sons and daughters. You will be more efficient in taking care of the unemployed people than the parents. It's completely idiotic. It is not an economic policy. It is the output of a social degeneration. Anything else? Thank you very much.